AFDDs are in. Protective conductor changes colour. Say goodbye to type AC RCDs. No more risk assessments for SPDs. Challenging times ahead for electrical designers. Foundation earthing nowhere to be seen, but stay to the end for the controversial point that did make it in. This is the eFIXX News at Penn, Amendment 2 Special. Hello and welcome. Amendment 2 to the 18th edition of BS7671 has finally landed, ending months of speculation and leaks. Mounting hysteria over the cost of AFDDs and fears over their wholesale adoption remain unjustified, as the requirements for these devices have turned out to be a requirement only in specific locations, namely higher-risk residential buildings, HMOs, purpose-built student accommodation and care homes. If, like us, you thought that higher risk residential buildings means places where people live, stay tuned for a Q&A video where we explain what it actually means. Also, if you're appalled at the cost of an AFDD, I refer you to the similar drama surrounding RCD protection on circuits with the advent of the 17th edition. The prices will come down. The long suspected Part 8 has arrived and relates, as shown in the draft for public comment, to a new term, the prosumer. This word is a portmanteau of producer and consumer and refers to the ongoing trend for homeowners to generate their own electricity, generally by solar PV. The section doesn't contain a lot of regulations, but at this stage is focused more on providing information. A major change that will lead to cries of outrage in many areas of the industry is a change to conductor colours. Now brace yourself for this one and make sure that you start running down the stocks of your old colours. The functional earth will now be pink instead of cream. Great news for Darren Cranis there. Another big change to the amendment is the removal of the need to have stickers plastered all over the front of your consumer unit. Section 514 used to require stickers explaining all the dangers associated with the installation on or near the consumer unit. But now all that information will be placed in a handover pack to be given to the homeowner. The only sticker that remains relates to warnings about multiple supplies, such as from solar PV. In fairness though, if you want to make your consumer units look like the pencil cases of teenage girls, you can still put warning stickers on there if you want. There's just no requirement for it. Some changes to testing now, as we see that there's been a change to insulation resistance testing on circuits with sensitive equipment. The previous version of the regs required that if a circuit contained sensitive equipment that could be damaged by higher than expected voltages, it could be tested at 250 volts DC. However, there is now a change to this that requires the circuit wiring to be tested at 500 volts DC before the sensitive equipment is connected, and then again at 250 volts DC following the connection being made. This will no doubt lead to much safer and more compliant installations. A clarification regarding testing RCDs has also been included. For some time now, electricians have been testing RCDs at half times, one times, five times, maybe chucking in a ramp test for good measure, and then repeating them all for both peaks of the waveform on the AC setting. Then, if it's an A-type RCD, doing the same thing all over again on an A-type setting on the meter. This is both onerous and now completely pointless, as it's more clearly expressed that the only test that needs carrying out is on the one-time setting at 0 and 180 degrees on the AC setting on your meter, no matter what type of RCD it is. Sticking with the theme of RCDs, it has also been much more clearly stated just what type AC RCDs are good for. Absolutely nothing. Say it again, y'all. AC RCDs are stated as only for use on purely resistive circuits where there is a guarantee that there is no DC component in that circuit whatsoever. So in a modern home, that would mean everything. Hence, type A is fast becoming the new baseline standard. Now, for those of us who spent hours and hours labouring over risk assessments for surge protection, perhaps calling up the local DSO to find lengths of above and below ground LV and HV supplies to a property and trying to figure out average lightning strikes per year in an area to avoid installing surge protection, you can now breathe a huge sigh of relief, as that entire process has been removed, and you pretty much just need to install surge to all domestic properties unless the homeowner has signed a document explicitly stating that they understand the associated risks of not having it and are happy to proceed. And if a homeowner understands that a £500 telly could be damaged by a surge and they choose to save a few quid by not installing an SPD, they're probably not used to making good life choices anyway. Or actually, more likely, it hasn't been properly explained to them. Now, some bad news for our electrical designer colleagues is there is a new requirement in section 422 explicitly stating that ceiling voids above corridors forming protected escape routes should not be used to run electrical services, which if you think about every hotel, school, hospital, or office building that you've ever worked on, that is pretty much the standard way of running services around a building. It seems those tricky constraints that we all face when designing building services just got a little trickier. No doubt now there'll be a vast amount of projects being pressured to start the design phase before the cut-off date of the First Amendment in September 2022. Circling back to inspection and testing, it is also apparent that the huge amount of tick boxes that have existed on the standard schedule since time immemorial have finally been condensed to a mere 14. Each of these headings covers the same elements as previous schedules of inspections, but will now feature one tick box indicating all elements under that heading have been inspected and the condition observed. For many years, the UK has been given some serious side eye from other countries in relation to the use of sockets in bathrooms, as other countries gleefully install them with a certain gung-ho attitude towards safety. Well, it seems the traditionally uptight British outlook on this issue has finally been relaxed. Previously, under BS 7671, there was a provision to allow for a socket in a bathroom, but it had to be at least 3 metres from the edge of the bath or shower. Well, JPL 64 have clearly given this some serious thought and decided that the time has come to make a much more laid-back approach to this subject by now allowing for a socket outlet installed in a bathroom a mere 2.5 metres from the edge of the bath or shower. Of course, if like me, you live in a fairly typical house, if I tried to install a socket 2.5 metres from the edge of my bath, it would be in my bed. There have been numerous changes to several sections of Part 7 in the Second Amendment, and really, there's far too many details to go into here. However, one significant change is to Section 712, which it may not surprise you to hear is the section on solar PV. This has gone from a mere 5 pages long to 15. As you can imagine, there's a lot to absorb from a section that is now tripled in length. And here's something that didn't make it into the Second Amendment, but we thought you'd like to see it anyway. The electrical industry can breathe a huge collective sigh of relief as the concerning subject of foundation earthing has not been included in this amendment. The proposed change may have seen electricians attending site prior to foundations being poured in order to ensure that an earthing arrangement was in place for the property, enabling, among other things, a prosumer property to go into island mode. This process, coming before first and second fix as it would, is something I like to refer to as a prefix. In fact, I'm so chuffed with this expression that I'm going to be lobbying hard to try and get foundation earthing into the 19th edition. Sorry about that. However, before we get too complacent about dodging a bullet on this issue, it's important to know that it is now recommended that an additional connection to earth is made to the main earthing terminal via an earth electrode. It seems that the humble earth rod is the hokey-cokey of the regulations. They're in, they're out, they're in, they're out. All that remains is a recommendation to shake them all about. And before you get too excited about an earth rod only being a recommendation, it seems we've been misunderstanding what recommendation means in the regulations. This has been clarified in a guide to the language used in BS 7671 at the start of the book. Watch out for a Q&A on this subject dropping very soon. This has been our take on the major changes to BS 7671, although as you can see, it seems to be a tightening and a clarifying of many areas rather than a major overhaul. And we look forward to hearing from you in the comments section below what you make of the new amendment. I've been Joe Robinson, and this has been the eFIXX News at Penn Amendment 2 Special. Goodbye.